Hey, how you guys doing? Hey, about 8 or 9 days ago when Kevin was here, I think it may have been his last night here, Tanya and I were standing in the back after service was over, and the pastor came up and he volunteered us. And he said, on January 13th, you guys are speaking, and I want you to speak on devil or Satan-proofing your home. And so we did not volunteer for this. We were voluntold for it, voluntold, actually. It wasn't a choice. He said, you're going to do it. And so he said, yes, sir. And so this morning, we're going to do our best to talk to you all and talk to ourselves as well about devil-proofing or Satan-proofing your home. And before I get started, I want to pray real quick. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I call right now for the fear of the Lord to fall in this house. Lord, I'm not asking for the peace of God to fall in this sanctuary or even myself. But Father, right now I summon the fear of the Lord. I summon the fear of the Lord to fall in this house. Lord, I ask that every heart be opened up right now to your voice. Lord, I ask that every mind be opened up right now to your voice. And Lord, that the fear of the Lord begin to drop in this house. Lord, I call for the fear of the Lord. I implore you, Lord, bring your fear. Bring the fear of the Lord right now into this house. Every demon assigned to destroy families, to destroy men, to destroy women, I break your power right now by the authority of Jesus Christ. I plead the blood of Jesus over this congregation. I plead the blood of Jesus that not another family will be destroyed, not another young person will be destroyed, not another child will be destroyed. And I call for the fear of God to fall in this house. Amen. As you guys may know, if you don't know, I'm Greg. This is my wife, Tanya. And we've gone on 22 years of marriage, and we have 3 kids, and the youngest one's birthday's today. Happy birthday, wherever you're at, Colton, 16 years old. And we've got a 17-year-old Brooke, 19-year-old Megan. And it's been a challenge raising kids, and it's still a challenge raising kids. But I'm a police officer by trade. I've got 19 years in with the police department here. And over the years, I've seen a lot of interesting things. And years ago when I was working uniform division, I work out of our detective bureau right now, and but about 15, 16, 17 years ago, I was on midnight shift, and we were called to a house burglary where the homeowners had caught someone breaking into their house. And I was the first one to get there, and it's like 3 o'clock in the morning, and this family, I don't remember who they were, but they were pretty much prepared for an intruder if it would ever occur. And this young man who was high on drugs and alcohol went to this house, and there's a sliding glass door, and he went through the sliding glass door. He was he did not have this planned out at all. And because he made a lot of racket when he broke through the the sliding door glass. And he was greeted by the homeowner who had a gun, and he was greeted by the homeowner's 17-year-old son with a baseball bat. And this is 3 o'clock in the morning. The young man broke into the basement. Dad and amped up son, greeted that young man downstairs. And when we got there, the person gladdest to see the police was the guy who broke into the home. And they had him down on a weight bench. And that 17-year-old was standing there with a baseball bat. And he was just waiting for that guy to get off the bench. Because the dad who had him at gunpoint said, you lay on that bench till the cops get here. And the 17-year-old who was, the adrenaline was flowing in that kid. And he looked at me and he was like, just give me the green light and I'll take care of it now. And I'm telling you, he was ready to tune that guy up. And that guy, even though he was high, he was scared to death. He wasn't about to get off that weight bench until we handcuffed him and took him out. And he was very glad to see us take him to jail and say goodbye to those homeowners. And so they had prepared for an intruder in their house. And so we're going to talk about that today. And you know, how do you Satan-proof your house? Do you ever fully Satan-proof your house? And right now, you know, this conversation today is directed toward the house of God. It's not directed toward people who don't acknowledge Jesus Christ. This is for the homeowners of Christ we're talking to today. And the church of God in America and throughout the world is under attack. Satan's number one goal, I believe, is to destroy the family. And I hate to give him props, but he's doing a pretty good job of it. When half of every marriage ends in divorce, that's a pretty good percentage, regardless of what sport you're in, 50% of them is going to break up. I'm going to let Tanya talk for a second. And I just want her to share with you guys her heart on this.
When we were talking about putting this together, we watched some videos, we prayed, we studied, but one of Jensen Franklin's videos, it just stuck with me the whole time. He told a story about this 50% divorce rate. And he said, you know, if you're getting your small child ready for school and you hear across the news that at the end of your road, there's a 50% chance there's going to be a bear there to attack your child. Are you going to throw your backpack on him and send him down the road and say, if you see a bear, run? Or are you going to prepare him or protect him when you know the enemy has that much success rate in this area? And I think a lot of times as Christians, we assume because we're Christians that 50% divorce rate is outside of the church. And it's sad to say, but sometimes it's higher within the church because we haven't taken measures to safeguard our marriage and to safeguard our home. And don't think because you wear that Christian banner that that's all you have to do to safeguard your home. There are steps you have to take to bring your home into the blessing that God's called it to. And without taking those steps, you actually at times are opening the door and inviting Satan right into your home. The attack doesn't even have to come from the outside. Sometimes we invite him in and he has a legal right to be there. And then we stand back and say, how did this happen? So today we're going to give some examples. We went through some Old Testament stories. We found an example of a father who, through his parenting, allowed Satan in his home. And you'll get to see what happens to God's presence when that happens. But then we're going to look at a man who took a different route and who chose the presence of God in his home and the blessings that came with that.
Throughout the 19 years of police work, I'm going to scoot up a little bit. Throughout 19 years of police work, I've had the opportunity to interview a lot of criminals. And a lot of guys that do burglaries and B&Es into businesses or into homes, you know, we've had the opportunity to sit down and they'll confess to us sometimes. Sometimes they don't. And but there's one common thread amongst guys or women even who break into your homes. And that is simply that they'll do a lot of drive-bys, walk-bys, ride your bicycle by, and they'll evaluate your home to whether or not they think it's an easy target. A thief will do the same thing as a lion or a tiger. They're going to look for the weakest animal in a pack, and that's the one they're going to attack. So if your home is, if you've got the garage door up with all your valuables visible as someone passes by on the street, or you keep your window, the blinds open, the big screen's right there, and you don't lock your doors, that's the target that a thief is going to pick. It's easy. The doors are unlocked. You just go in and you steal what you want and you leave. The lights are not left on at nighttime. And, you know, a more prudent homeowner is going to keep all their doors locked. They're going to keep the outside lights on. If they're on vacation, they're not going to put it on Facebook that they're on vacation. They're going to call their neighbors and say, hey, I'm going to be gone for a few days. How about, you know, keeping a look at after my house? They may have dogs that bark inside or even dogs that are outside. They may buy a security system, an ADT-type system, to where if someone breaks in the home, you know, it goes off and the police respond. But the same thing applies in the spirit realm. And so I want to talk real quick, who is Satan and what does he do? And the Word of God says this in John 10:10, the thief, which is Satan, does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. And Jesus says that I've come that they may have life, that they may have it more abundantly. But Satan has three jobs in his existence, and that's to come and steal relationships in your life, to steal your health, to steal your finances, to kill you, to kill every emotion inside of you, to kill every relationship in your family, to kill any generational blessing that your family has. And he comes simply to destroy you because he hates your guts. And I would say this, I don't know if Satan has the levels of hate, but he hates Christians a whole lot more than he hates non-Christians. Because you oppose, what lives in you opposes everything inside him. He hates you and he desires to kill you physically. And if he can't kill you physically, he desires to kill every relationship in your life to where you are of no threat to him. That's what he does. Satan comes to kill. He comes to steal. And he comes to destroy. The Word of God in John 8:44 says this, that you are the father, this is Jesus speaking, you are of the father the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources or his own native language. For he is a liar and the father of it. He is the father of all lies. The way Satan's going to come in to kill, steal, and destroy in your home is he's going to lie. And it may become thoughts in your head or it may be acted out through people. But he is the father of all lies.
We're technically challenged.
This is very, very true. I want to tell you, talk to you about a story. And to do this, I have to move. I cannot sit on that stool, so forgive me.
And I'm perfectly comfortable right here, so I'm staying.
How does the enemy come in and destroy a godly people or a godly family? In the book of Numbers, in the Old Testament, there's an awesome story that's really, God gives three chapters to it. And it's about a guy named King Balak and a prophet named Balaam. Balaam, I believe, was initially a godly prophet. Through the course of time, his downfall was greed. Balaam had a talent or a gift, which a lot of people in this culture do. He could communicate with demon spirits, and yet he could hear the voice of God. He was a bipolar prophet. And King Balak was king of Moab, M-O-A-B, Moab. And Moab was a very evil country. They sacrificed children. They served really the god of Baal. And it was very common that in that culture, in any culture that serves Baal, sexual immorality is the basis of it. It is the foothold of their religion. Orgies, homosexuality, prostitution, that's how they served their god. Israel was moving toward Moab, and they had destroyed every nation that came against them. King Barak sees this happening and he knows they're coming this way. And there's over 1 million Israelites. And he knows if they've wiped out the other countries, we're next. And so he comes up with an idea and he says, I'm going to summon the prophet Balaam and I'm going to pay him whatever he wants to come and curse Israel. Because he knew that his army could not go out and defeat Israel. So he brings in a false prophet. Now listen, this prophet used divination, sorcery, witchcraft, which from beginning to end in the Word of God is an abomination. I may get onto this later, but I'll just... Sorcery in my opinion, sexual immorality and sorcery are the number one and number two things attacking the body of Christ today in America. Sorcery has made a comeback, and it's exploding in the movies. It's exploding on entertainment, and it's exploding toward children. And so Balaam used divination, sorcery, whatever he could to curse people. The king says, I know whoever you bless is blessed, and I know whoever you curse will be cursed. So the prophet Balaam comes, and the king takes him to three different strategic places to where he can look down and see the people of Israel. Balaam tells King Barak, I'll do one thing, and I will speak what God tells me. And every time he would go alone, waiting to hear from the Lord, you know, can I curse this people? Can I curse them? The Lord would say, you can only bless them. You can only bless them. At that point, apparently, Israel was living a pretty righteous lifestyle as a whole. And he would go back to the king and say, I can't curse him. I can only bless him. And it would make the king furious. So a long story short, and I really encourage you to read this story. It's Numbers 22, I think, through 25. At the very end, Balaam says, I cannot curse them, but here, king, let me tell you what's getting ready to happen. They're going to come, and they're going to wipe you out. Balaam goes back, and the king did not pay him for his divination or sorcery or whatever he was trying to do as far as to curse Israel. And the Moabites had a very good idea that is working in the body of Christ today. King Barak had a very good idea. He said this, I'm going to send the most beautiful women in Midian and Moab, and I'm going to send them into the Israelite camp. Listen to me, especially you young men or even old men. Sex is an incredibly powerful tool for good and for evil. He sent these women in, and these women serve a pagan god. They went into the tents of Israel and began to hook up with the Israelite men. And listen to me, I don't know how else to say this, but once you give in to a woman outside of wedlock in the realm of sexual intercourse, guys, you become property of her, especially when she uses it for deviant reasons, as these women did. They dolled themselves up, they went into the camp, and they began to seduce the Israelite men, which was forbidden. They were not, Israelite men, and they were not even allowed to be around the people from Moab. And they begin to have sex with them. And once a woman has sex outside of wedlock, she has a great power over you. And that could be reversed as well. A guy can have power over the woman due to that time of intimacy. But they began to serve their gods. They began to serve the Moabite gods. And God says, now I will curse you. The king, Barak, was he was a smart guy. He sacrificed to his gods, but he realized, if I could get Israel to curse itself or to sin against God, then I have them. God will destroy them, and we won't even have to worry about them attacking us. In 2012 and in the previous years, that same attack is occurring in the body of Christ. Now, I'm not talking about outside these walls. It's occurring everywhere. But Satan has a strategic plan against the body of Christ to seduce the men and women through sexual immorality. When Israel fell into this sin, God struck 24,000 people dead. This is how serious this is. You have Moses and the leaders of Israel weeping and fasting because the plague has hit their people. And there's a young man who has his Midianite prostitute whore girlfriend. And as it says that he takes her before the leaders of Israel into his tent. He has no regard. He has no fear of the Lord. A plague is falling upon the people. And this guy, in front of Israel, in front of the leaders, When Moses and the leaders are calling for a fast, calling for a time of mourning, calling for this plague to stop, he takes the girl right in front of them to his tent to hook up with her. And a young man of God, a young prophet of God, saw this occur. He takes his spear and he goes into this tent, into your home. And it says that he drove this spear through them at the same time, which most Bible scholars believe that they were having sex. He was on top of her, and he drove this spear through them and killed them both and stopped the plague upon the Israelite people after 24,000 people were killed.
I saw that. You guys are laughing at us. What Satan used was the intimacy of the master bedroom to bring sin into an entire nation. And that happens so much in today's culture, and I'm not talking necessarily about a husband or a wife committing adultery. I'm talking about the sins that we invite into our own home, whether it be through television, music, any form of media. There's not very many bedrooms anymore that don't have a TV sitting right in it. And it, even though you may not be committing the sins, when you watch them on that TV in your bedroom, you become desensitized, or as he said last night, desinitized, where the sin does not become that big of a deal anymore because you've watched it so much that your conscience becomes seared. And when a parent sets that tone in the master bedroom, you can't go to your kids and say, don't watch that, don't be a part of that. Because you've already set the path of the home as the leaders of the home. And when the enemy comes in, he can only stay when he has legal right. He has legal right to stay when you've invited him in. There are kids watching shows at a very young age that when I was little wouldn't have even been allowed to be on TV. The sitcoms, there's not a sitcom out there right now that does not glorify dysfunction in a family, that does not glorify homosexuality, that doesn't glorify the Antichrist design for a family versus a godly family. As a matter of fact, if there is a godly family demonstrated in the show, it's typically to mock it and make fun of it. And when you expose yourself to that, you redefine family without even realizing it. And when you do that, you know, the prophet recognized the sin and dealt with it. If you don't keep the presence of Christ in the master bedroom and in the home, you will not recognize the sin when you invite it in. And a lot of times, you know, Moses and the leaders of the church were seeking God, saying, help us, get us out of this mess. And there's so many times, you know, for 20 years we've ministered with kids. And there's been so many times parents have come to us and said, I don't know why my kid's doing this. And you ask a few simple questions and you realize they were only acting out everything that was being demonstrated in their home. And without even realizing it, the parents, by allowing compromise in their home, were allowing the path for their child to be set.
I want to ask you a question. If sin is not brought into the Christian body through the internet and television and music, then how's it being brought into it? I want you to think about that for a second. There's not very many men and women in here tonight that were at the bar last night. There's not very many people that went down to on Ohio Avenue, the porn shop right there, and went inside and watched pornography inside one of those booths where men go there and masturbate, row of paper towels right there. I doubt that there's anybody in this house today that were in those places yesterday. I doubt there's anybody in this house today that slept with someone other than your wife or husband yesterday. So then, how is it Satan's attack on the body of Christ, how's he going to present and an attack on you. I am convinced 100% that the Spirit of God told me this week that the enemy is within our own homes. Because there's a vacancy sign in the Spirit on our house. There's a vacancy sign that says, come on in. And he comes in through media and entertainment and music. How else can he do it?
You have to keep in mind, every single thing that is created has a creator. Movies are created. There's a creator behind it. And if it's not glorifying God, who created it? Every music you listen to, man, there is a spirit behind that music. And we've joked about this, but in our home, you know, in my home, I have always said that there's really only one thing in my home that is right, and that's breathing. Everything else has some sort of privilege associated with it, right down to your eating. Because if you can't honor and respect the family, you won't join us at the table with us. You can eat in your room. Everything besides breathing has some sort of privilege associated with it. And for some reason in this culture, parents have given children rights that are not rights, they're privileges. And until parents grasp that and realize your job is not to make your child happy all the time. That's not your job. Your job is not to be your child's friend. Your job is to be the godly authority to administer the fear of God in your home. Because when you do that, you teach them to fear the Heavenly Father. If they don't learn how to submit to authority from a parent, how are they going to submit to the authority of Christ as they're an adult? I mean, that's really the whole reason we have children, is to raise them in the fear and admonition of Christ. And so many times, parents today, they think if their child cries, they've done something wrong. If their child is not happy, something's wrong. There are times as my kids grew up and they were younger, I told them no to things for no good reason, because it had been a while since they'd had a no. Because your kids need to learn that they're not the God of the home. That you were not put there to serve them. They are put here to serve Him. And if you as a parent serve them, they will never serve Christ at the calling and full capacity they're supposed to. Don't be their friend. Be the God-given authority God has told you to be.
I'm going to jump back into the bedroom. The master bedroom has a master name to it for a reason. Because what happens in that bedroom may master you. How many people in here have a TV in their bedroom? How many people? A bunch.
How many have one in your kid's bedroom also?
How many have a computer in your bedroom? Okay, listen. Throughout this week, as I was praying about this, I mean, the Lord, just it was nonstop, bedroom, bedroom, bedroom. And I'm just going to say it like it's just because you're married doesn't mean you can't enter into sexual sin. And as you're watching pornography, just because your kids don't know you're watching it, doesn't mean that that sin, that curse is not going to fall on them. I wasn't going to go there, but I'm going there. Alcohol. Just because you can control it, a drink here, a drink there, and I'm not busting you for alcohol so much. Beer here, a little wine there. What you can control may be the doorway for the curse to fall on your son or daughter. That's just how that works. Just because your kids don't know you're doing it doesn't mean it won't fall on them, because in the spirit realm, there are no secrets. Everything is wide open. That's why sexual sin is so important to control or to abstain from. because it's going to fall on your children if you don't repent from it. It's going to fall on them. Listen to me, men. Porn is huge in America. Porn is huge everywhere. And some of you may sit here this morning, men and women, and say, you know, I'm just appalled by that. That is gross. I don't know how people can watch it. That's great. But let me give you an example. I've never been tempted by drugs. In police work, everyone we deal with is high on drugs or alcohol or prescription medications. If someone ties me down and pumps cocaine into me, I'm going to get high. And there's going to be a desire at a later point to feel that way again, even though I opposed what it was. And in some marriage beds in the house of God, in order to spice up the marriage bed, we tune in, and you don't. And what's deviant anymore is you don't even have to drive to the store to get a movie. You just simply download it from your cable company, and you're in your bedroom, and nobody else knows that you and your wife are watching porn to spice up the marriage. Now listen to me. You say, well, Greg, if you watch it, it's going to amp you up. That's why people watch it. It makes them feel good. But men, if you're bringing that into your bedroom to spice up mama because there's no action, no excitement in the bedroom, in a few years' time, what you thought would spice up your bedroom may cause her to walk right out the door with another woman or another man, because that satisfaction of getting high only requires getting higher at another time. And the sexual sin of lust and perversion that you're bringing upon your family is bringing the enemy right in your bedroom. You're sleeping with the enemy. And you'll want more, more, and more. Listen, there's very few altar calls in America for men to come up for pornography. The fastest growing audience of pornography in America is women. This past year at youth camp, the number of teenage girls that say, I have a problem with pornography, blew us adults away. It is a spirit, and it will kill you. It'll kill your relationships. It'll kill your marriage. If you think it's going to spice up your sex life for a period of time, ultimately it's going to kill it. Because here's the deal. She, no matter how pretty your wife may be, is not going to look like what's on the computer. And let me go one step further for the guys who are secret pornographers. That woman you're masturbating to wouldn't have she would not give you the time of day if you met her at the mall unless you paid her. In the body of Christ, the sexual sin is an open invitation for Satan to come on in the house. And let me say this, and this is a tough word, but I know the Lord told me to say it. If you're in sexual sin right now, you're not married, and you're hooking up with your boyfriend or girlfriend, I don't care if you're 14 or 15 years old, or in your 50s or your 30s or 20s, listen to me. All you're doing, whether it's her or you, the guy, you're hooking up, or you're living together, you're doing nothing more than trying to sanctify prostitution. Because if the reason she's staying with you is for financial gain and a place to stay, she's nothing more than a whore, and you're nothing more than a John paying her, and vice versa. I mean, that's just what it is. I mean, that's what it is. Because the sex is the center of an adulterous and a fornicating relationship. And ladies, you may be the pursuer, or he may be the pursuer. But if there's not a commitment, if there's not enough commitment to say, I want to bed down with you after we're married, then you're living a lie. You've got someone who's not committed to God, and you've got someone that's surely not committed to you. Let me use this as an example. Why is sex outside of marriage wrong? Number one commandment. I shall have no other gods before me. sex outside of the marriage, and I'm talking to the Christian homes of this valley. The bed becomes the altar of sacrifice. Because every false god, or every god, requires a sacrifice. And the sacrifice to the god of sex or sexual immorality, the bed becomes the altar. But what's the sacrifice? The sacrifice is you and her. And your salvation. That's the sacrifice. The bed becomes the altar, and the sacrifice becomes each one of you. Because you have put the god of sexual immorality, higher than the word of God. And so you've made it an idol. And every idol has a worshiper. And in this case, when you worship each other through illicit sex, you have put that desire over the word of God, making you an idolater. And the Lord says, you're not to serve anyone but me. So you're committing the sin, a sexual sin, but you're also committing the sin of idolatry, because you're putting this need, this desire, higher than the word of God. And this invites the enemy into your home. And when you come to church, you're not going to get the closeness, the intimacy of God, because you've already put him second.
Go ahead and read that.
The word tells us in 2 Corinthians 6:14 to not be unequally yoked. It says, do not be yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Christ and Satan? What does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? What agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will live with them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. Therefore, come out from them and be separate, says the Lord, touching no unclean thing, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you will be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty.
Now, a few weeks ago, I'm going to give you some of our dirt. Tanya and I, we don't watch very many movies. We've seen maybe, I don't know, 3 movies in the last 5 or 6 years. That's just not something we do. And so a month or so ago, Tanya and I went to see a movie. And I didn't check it out. I heard it was a pretty good movie. And we went to see it. I didn't even, and this is my fault, so I'm just taking the hit, publicly. As the movie came on, the first thing that I saw was a woman's breast. She was naked. And Denzel Washington movie. Thanks, Denzel. And we looked at each other, and I said, what's this thing rated? And because that means we don't see movies. And she said, I'm not sure. And
I was just happy to get invited on a date, so.
I'm not necessarily the most romantic guy in town, but. So we begin to watch this movie, and I mean, it was F this, F that, Jesus this, Jesus that. And there was like 25 people in the theater, and I looked at her and I was like, is there anyone here from The Rock? And
you know something's wrong when you're embarrassed and no one's looking.
And we're in the dark, you know, it's dark. And I'm thinking, it was embarrassing. And we made it through about 15 minutes of that nonsense.
And during that time, we saw fornication, drug use, foul language. I mean, it was a pretty active 15 minutes. We were exposed to a lot.
And I looked at her and I said, we're out of here. And so we got up and left, and I told her, I said, I hope nobody sees us coming out of this theater, because that's not what we do. I said, Lord, you know, I repent. You know, my bad for not researching a little bit better. And so when we walked out there, you know, we're like, that won't happen again. That's how, you know, Satan gets a foothold. If it doesn't bother you when Jesus Christ's name is just being bashed left and right. And it's going to happen out in culture as you're out shopping or whatever. But when you invite it into your own home, you're desensitizing. Listen, you know what? 30 years ago, as Pastor talks about the Three's Company came on with John or Jack Ritter, and he was the first really the homosexual person on TV, even though he wasn't. He was faking it. And you know, just 30 years or 25 years later, man, you can't watch TV anymore without that being jammed down your throat. And you can take a dart and throw it at any TV show in America now, and it's going to glorify sin. And that is exactly what Satan's intent is to do, to bring the curses on the body of Christ.
When it talks about being unequally yoked, a lot of times we think about our husband and wife. But whether you realize it or not, what you put in front of your eyes, you're yoking with, because there's a spirit behind it. And when you expose yourself to it, you are yoking yourself with something that was designed and came straight out of the pits of hell. And your children do this. I'm talking young children do this from a very young age within the permission and the safety of their own home. How many times have you sat and watched the TV with your children? How many times have you, if your child locks their bedroom door at their home, shame on you. That's your home, and what is played in that room, whether it be music, TV, or internet, do you know that as a parent, you will stand accountable for that? And saying, well, he had his door locked, I didn't want to invade his privacy, is probably not going to fly when you're standing in front of Jesus.
Yeah, if you need to take the doors off your kids' rooms, take the doors off, and I'm not joking when I say that.
We have a policy at our house. Each one of my kids, they're teenagers. They all have a cell phone in their hand. But make no mistake, they know who owns that cell phone. As long as I'm paying the bill and as long as I'm paying for the internet in that home, it's actually mine. But they have a privilege of using it while they're there. But with it being mine, I have the passcodes. I can pick it up and look at it at any time. The right to privacy is a false doctrine in today's culture. The right to privacy breeds sin in your home. What I want to know is, I don't care if another parent or another person looks at me and says, oh my gosh, you might bruise them, you might hurt them. I care more about the day I stand in front of Jesus Christ and have to give an account for them. And I will know who their friends are. I will know where they're at all times. I will know what they're watching. And I will not apologize for it, because I take my responsibility seriously.
Let me speak to you, the parents in this room that have young children. And as our teens or our kids are growing up in the latter teen years, your biggest challenge is going to be what they're listening to, who they're listening to, what they're watching, because every year new technology comes out and they're listening, they're talking to people through Xbox, playing games with somebody across the country. You've got to stay on top of it. And the cell phone's the number one thing that's going to, Satan will use to bring a teenager or a young person into some sort of sin. You have to be vigilant on it. Now listen to me. In 1 Samuel, Eli, he was the priest of Israel. He was the guy. He was the judge. What Eli said went. And he had two sons. I think it's pronounced Hophni and Phinehas. And they were also priests of the temple of God. And the Bible describes them as very wicked men, very wicked young men.
They were churchgoers.
They were.
Their dad had them at church every single service. They were not worshiping pagan gods. They were growing up right in the house of the Lord.
However, these two priests in the house of God began to pervert everything. The women who worked at the tent of meeting, they were having sex with, whether the women wanted to or not. When people would bring in the sacrificial offerings, they took it. They ate it when they were not supposed to eat it. And they said, if you don't give it to us, then we'll take it by force. We'll take it by violence. Everything that these two young men did was an abomination to the Lord. But here's the problem, parent. Eli goes to his sons and he basically says this: I hear that you guys are doing a lot of bad things. Knock it off. And it says that his two sons, in the Greg Nangle version, blew him off. And he gave them a very weak rebuke. A very weak rebuke to two young men who were in full-blown sin, who lived and worked in the house of God. It was Eli's, the responsibility came back onto Eli for what his two sons were doing. It comes back on Greg and Tanya, what their three children do as long as they're in my home. These two guys live with their priest, or with their father Eli, but they were raping the women, having sex with whoever they wanted to, and using violence to get what they wanted.
And although your children may not be doing it, they may be watching it on a weekly basis.
And so, if there's any predators in this church who come here for the sole thing of hooking up with young men or young women for sexual immorality, all I can say is may the Lord have mercy on your soul. Because this is what these two men did. May the Lord have mercy on your soul if that is your hidden agenda. Eli refused to bring a harsh correction to him. What they were doing was worthy of death. And really, he should have had them killed in order to bring purity back. And get this, it said that men and women began to not come to the temple to bring their sacrifices because the leadership was so perverted in the house of God. There are people in this church here today that are called to be gatekeepers, meaning gatekeepers kept impurity out of the temple of God. In your home, every parent in here is to be a gatekeeper of what comes in your house. In Old Testament times, the gatekeepers kept the unclean people out. If you had a disease that was leprosy, that was contagious, they kept you out. Any impure thing, they kept you out. They were the gatekeepers. And whether you're a parent or not, or you're just husband and wife, you're the gatekeeper of your marriage. Because that's a covenant with God. And as the gatekeeper, you keep impurity. You keep sin out of your marriage. You keep TV out of your marriage. And I realize that everything on TV is sinful. I mean, you're hard-pressed to not find TV that's not filled with sin. And so are you saying, great, we cut it out? What do you think Jesus would say? No, that's, the Word of God says, a little bit of leaven ruins the whole thing. The whole batch of dough. And so what you allow today will increase and increase and increase. And so if you have to cut out your TV, that's exactly what I'm saying. You cut your TV out. If you can't stop the temptation of watching stuff that glorifies sin, there's a reason the body of Christ has 50% divorce rate. Because when you're fed that every single day, it eventually comes out. Eli caused the entire nation of Israel to suffer 30,000 deaths. Because of a weak rebuke, he allowed those young men to stay in the position of priesthood.
2 Samuel 2:29 tells us why he did that. And I think as a parent, this is like one of the most important learning lessons you can have in disciplining your children. Why do you scorn my sacrifice and offering that I prescribed for my dwelling? This is Christ asking Eli, How could you do this in the temple of the Lord? Why do you honor your sons more than me? And you have to ask yourself, when you withhold discipline from your children, is it because you fear your children more than you fear God? You fear disappointing them, or you fear the backlash from them more than you fear God? Because that was Eli's downfall. Eli let his children run the house rather than taking ownership and headship and him administering discipline when it needed to happen.
And as a result of his allowing sin into his home, the ark of God, the presence of God that Israel would take into battle and enemies would be destroyed, the ark of God was used by two perverted priests, two men in the church. As they began to go into battle, they said, hey, let's take the Ark of God. They had no relationship with God. In fact, everything they did opposed God. And they said, let's take the ark with us because it wins every battle. God was an entity, not a person, not a relationship. And they took it into battle. And Phinehas and Hophni were both killed because the Lord prophesied to Samuel, I'm going to destroy that family. I'm going to kill them for their sin. And he killed them both on the same day. But the ark of God, the presence of God, was taken by the Philistine army who were pagans. They worshiped Baal, and they took the presence of God with them. So when you allow that sin in your home, or if Greg Nangle allows known sin in his home, the presence of God is going to leave your home. It's going to leave. God's not going to let his holiness, his righteousness, presence stay in a sin-filled home. It just doesn't happen. God made the point of, he said, I'll let my presence go to an evil people before I leave it amongst this group. And so when Christians say, you know, I'm just believing for this, I'm believing for this, I'm praying for the blessings of God on my home, and you wonder why, we wonder why our prayers are not answered. If you were God, and your children are entertaining every sort of sexual sin on television, every type of music that glorifies Satanism, that glorifies every sin known to man, would you bless them? Would you bless them? The same trick that Balak used upon Israel still is working today. It's just packaged differently. I've not had a beautiful woman yet knock on my door and say, I'd like to have sex with you, Greg. But it comes in the form of TV. It comes in the form of the attempt to download it on the net. It's the same practice. When the ark left, Eli died as well. He died as well. When the messenger came and said, your two sons are dead, Eli fell off his stool because he was fat and obese, and he died. He was elderly, more likely broke his neck.
The scripture actually said his family from that point on did not have an old man in it. They all died at a young age.
And Eli had the chance to repent, as all of us in this house today had the chance to repent for letting sin in our house. How do you devil-proof your home? You got to get the sin out of your home. And what we have all compromised is, well, that's not that bad. That's not that bad. That's not that bad. God says, it's that bad. I'll remove my presence from you, and I'll curse your children. I'll curse your children. You keep it up. You keep bringing that trash into your house, I'll curse your children. I'm not a grace type guy. I'm not a grace type preacher. All I know is this. Jesus' 12 disciples, every single one of them was martyred. They were killed. They weren't preaching the gospel of grace. So figure that one out if you're tuned into this false doctrine of grace and mercy. Those boys weren't killed for preaching the gospel of grace. And they lived in the same covenant time that we live today, after Jesus. That has nothing to do with this message. That had nothing to do with this message.
That was not in our notes.
You keep on sinning. You keep on sinning. You find out how much mercy and grace is there. Because when every one of us is going to stand before God one of these days, and we've all said, when I see God, I'm going to say this. You're not going to say nothing. You're going to fall flat on your face and beg that he keeps you in the kingdom of heaven instead of sending to you to an eternal hell. It's a reverent fear when you're in the presence of God. But somehow in the homes of America, in the churches of America, there are young people, adults, that can be in the house in the presence of God and go outside these walls and sin like there is no God. They are the modern day Hophni and Phinehas. They are the modern day version of that. They are predators in the house of God. There's predators in your own home. If you weed out the sin in your home, you watch it weed out of the church. Because when you take care of it all starts right here. It starts with this temple first. Then it starts with this marriage, this covenant with God, this temple second. Then it comes under the covenant of family with those three. And then it comes into this house. And so what I'll accept in my home, I'll accept in the house of the Lord. And the Lord says, there is no compromise. Compromise is simply this. It's I give something and you give something so we're both happy. It doesn't work that way with God. Just need a little extra loving on the side, God. A little alcohol here. Hey, if you're going to... You might as well smoke marijuana once a week if a couple drinks is all right. What's the difference? Why give the enemy a foothold in your marriage? Why give the enemy a foothold?
I think a lot of times in the church, we bring our children to church to visit his presence. But if his presence isn't in your home, they don't learn to live in it. If they're not living in his presence, they can't battle against this world. There's a difference between teaching them religion to come visit his presence and feel good when you're here. But you guys, when you walk out that door, man, it takes discipline to carry his presence with you. It takes discipline to make the choices to say, I will be a gatekeeper in my home. You know, in Deuteronomy, it tells us that the words that come from him, we should say them when we're walking, when we're lying, when we're sleeping. They should be on doorposts in our home. It's not an easy walk to maintain his presence in your home. But every time you compromise, every time you let the sin in your home, you're making a choice over his presence. And that's what your children see. And I don't care how young they are, they know compromise. Because we're supposed to come to him as a child. Don't discount the spiritual side of your children. They know compromise. They recognize it. They know they come here and hear one thing, and they go home and see another. And that teaches them the hypocrisy of Eli's sons.
2 Samuel, I believe it's chapter 6. I'd read it to you, but it'll take too long. King David is attempting to bring the Ark of the Covenant back home. They were transporting the Ark in a way that was not really biblical. And as a result, as they're carrying this Ark, somebody began to stumble, and this guy named, I believe it's pronounced Uzzah, he reaches out to steady the ark. You know, and the ark's not very big. It's like, 2 feet by 2 feet? And he reaches out to steady it as someone had stumbled, and when he touched it, God struck him dead immediately. And this was a parade. King David's in the front. This was a huge deal, bringing the ark back. And when David saw this guy killed, it says that it made him mad. He's like, how, he was just trying to steady the ark and you struck him dead. And they stopped the procession immediately. And David, in his anger, said, we're not going any further. We're not taking the ark with us. Let's find a place for it. And they found a place for it in a person's home. Now get this. Imagine being this person. His name is
Obed-Edom.
I wish it was Jim or Jack, but it's Obed.
We'll just call him OB.
OB. Apparently, this guy at that time was a godly man. And it says that he says, I'll take the ark. Bring it to my house. The ark, can you imagine bringing in the physical presence of God in your home for 3 months? 90 days of walking around in your living room. The ark of God is right there. Your children, your wife, the ark of God is there. You touch this thing wrong, you die. This thing has killed thousands of people in war when they would take it because it is the manifest physical presence of God. And Obed-Edom said, bring it to my house. And for 3 months, he honored the presence of God. And it says that his entire family was blessed. God in a box happened in this guy's house. For 3 months, God is in a box. And apparently he honored it correctly because everyone in his home was blessed. After 90 days, they take the presence of God out of his house. Let me back up to make this a little bit more real. The presence of God, when his children, whether they were little kids, teenagers, or adults, when they were in his home, they were walking a very fine line because they knew what happened if sin came in the camp or sin came in the room. They're going to drop dead. And for 3 months, the father of that house is, you better watch it. The presence of God is here. The presence of God is here. You won't be bringing in that music in this tent. You won't be bringing porn in this tent.
If you know the result of the sin is death, do you give a weak rebuke? He did not give a weak rebuke because the reality of death, when you brought sin in, they witnessed. Whether you realize it or not, we're in the same situation today. The result of the sin you let in your home is death.
You know, in this day and age, if the Ark of the Covenant was recovered and brought in your home and laid before your flat screen TV, would you be watching the things that you've been watching? Would I be watching the things I've been watching? Because this message is to Greg and Tanya as much as it is to you. I'm almost convinced to hang the Word of God off my TV. As a result, this is no different than the presence of God. This is no different than the presence of God. And I'm not saying God's going to strike you dead. I'm not saying he's not either. Because in New Testament times, there were people struck dead. We're in New Testament times. You can dwell on that if you choose to. But if the presence of God is in your house, it brings correction. When the fear of the Lord is in your home or in your marriage, I'm not doing that. I'm not talking to that coworker like that. I'm not flirtatious with her. If she comes to me and she's got a little Jezebel going on with her and she's got the hots, you know, for you or for me, I'm shutting that down quick. I'm shutting that down quick. That's not how you talk to someone that's not your wife. That's not how you rub shoulders with someone that's not your husband or wife. There's purity in the marriage. It's a covenant with God. You've got the ark between you. It says that his entire family served the Lord. It goes on to say that after 90 days, when they took the ark out, Obed-Edom liked it so much, he says, we're moving. We're going with it. And the leaders of the church put him in charge. He and his family, 68 of them, it says, served the Lord in the house of God. All of his sons, all of his daughters, all of his grandchildren, all of his great-grandchildren are serving the Lord. They're gatekeepers. He honored it for 90 days in his home. Who else would be better to honor when it's in the sanctuary? If you'll honor the fear of the Lord in your home, God will honor your children. You won't have to begin to pray for them that this and that happens. Because when the manifest presence of God is in your house, blessings come. Blessings come.
You have to understand, he made a choice to pursue the presence. He was blessed where he was. It wasn't like there wasn't blessing where he was. His family was already blessed. They had already honored God. He chose to take that risk of the unknown to see if God would continue blessing him, even if he moved just to follow his presence.
Hey, Trevor, come on up, please. When David, when they brought the ark back to the temple, David is singing and dancing. There's a procession going. And you've heard the story. David's dancing crazy before the Lord. He's down to basically covering his loins, and he's dancing crazy because he's so excited the presence of God is coming back to where it's supposed to be. And if there's adults in this room that you've had an unsaved son or daughter come back to Christ, you know that feeling. There's dancing. There's joy. You're like, yes! They've come back home. David is dancing crazy. And this is, this next segment right here, next few minutes, this is for the culture of this church, because there's not very many cultures in this city, in this area, with the culture this church has. Every Sunday, every Wednesday, every Saturday, you'll see men and women in front of the sanctuary dancing before the Lord. Some back there, some back here, some up there, dancing before the Lord. You'll see men and women lay down before the Lord, honoring Him. David's wife, her name is, I believe it's pronounced Michael, but I'm going to call her Michelle. Because Michelle watches him. And listen, here's where they're unequally yoked. David had several wives, and this woman did love him initially, but she watched this, and it says all the young women were kind of watching King David. He was buff and good-looking. The Bible says he was a good-looking guy. And she's jealous because all these, you know, little giddy girls who are watching the king, you know, he's unclothed and he's dancing. He's the king. And she gets ticked off at him and says, "Weren't you something today dancing before your God like that?" And he says basically this: "I don't care if you like it or not. I'll dance, I'll do whatever I want to unto the Lord. If you won't find glory with it, they will. They'll find glory with it." And as the wife ridiculed the husband for his praise, God closed up her womb and she never had a child. I've been a guy that's dealt with pride in my life, as most men do, and even women. And I used to, you guys have heard me say, I used to hate the dance. I hated the dance in church. I hated a lot of boisterous show of emotion. And the Lord has broke me over a period of years of that. And now it's very easy for me to lay prone before the Lord, whether it's here or in my home or up in youth. To bow before Him is not an issue anymore. It used to be a big issue because who am I that I'm going to bow to something I can't see? The sin of pride is very, very prominent in America. You don't tell any American what to do.
There are some of you in here today, and that presence of God is not what you come home to. That presence of God, maybe it's been there at times, but the consistency of keeping it there has been a struggle. And our hope today is that you realize that the presence of God that you keep in your home can be there abundantly all the time by the choices you make. Because He's not holding back. He's willing, able, and ready to be there to solve the problems, to resolve the issues. He's waiting on you to prepare the place for Him. You know, it's our job in our homes to have that mercy seat where His presence rests. It's our job to prepare that place for Him. It says He looks for a place to rest. Today, our hope is that you realize that the Satan that's out there doesn't have the power that you think he does. The power is within the Holy Spirit that resides in your home. There are men in this house who have made choices where you said, I'm going to draw the line. I'm going to say this is where it is. And I'm going to ask you women to check yourself. Have you countered His authority? Have you mocked Him in His place of headship in your home? Maybe you're just as happy to come to church, but maybe you're not so happy when he calls for something to be changed in the home. Or maybe you're standing between Him and your children when He tries to bring discipline. Maybe you're the mom that says, "Oh, no, don't do that. I mean, I know it's bad, but we'll it'll be all right." Are you Michelle to the David in your home? Are you what's possibly allowing sin to stay in the camp? I ask you to check yourself, because there's been times in our marriage where I've had to go to Him and say, "Sorry, you were right, I was wrong." And I've had to submit to the authority. And I know Charity and I had this conversation the other night. The word submit in today's culture has been so twisted. True authority in a woman's life comes through submission. When your husband has submitted to God and you submit to him, there's safety, security, and authority in that. When your children don't have the mindset, you know, don't be the you wait till your dad gets home mom. When you submit to him, you're operating in his authority. Your children should have as much reverence and respect for you as the mother as they do for him as the father. And if you don't understand that, what you really do is become unequally yoked with him. Because if they're allowed to do it when dad's not home, then you've taught them compromise. You've also, without realizing it, taught them manipulation. Because they will learn to manipulate you to get what they want. Because when he's drawn the line and when he's said no more, but they know, okay, well, that's when he's here. But when he's gone, mom's in charge and I can get away with it. You do not understand the spiritual lesson you are teaching your children. It is the same as bringing them in the house and saying, oh, don't hit your brother here. But when you go home, it's okay. You teach them that what they hear at church is okay for when you're at church. But when the presence of God is gone, they can do what they want. Don't allow compromise in the covenant relationship between your husband and wife. Do not be afraid of submission. Because when you're in submission, you are under the covering of the blessing that God has bestowed upon the head of the house. And when you step in under that, you've given God authority in your home.
Okay, listen, we're going to end this thing here in a few minutes. And I'm getting ready to make a lot of men in this room very, very uncomfortable. And I'm just doing what the Lord told me. Isaiah 45, verses 23 and 24. This is God talking. Man, he's the real deal. I don't know. I mean, he's just the real deal. He says this, by myself I have sworn, my mouth has uttered in all integrity, a word that will not be revoked. Before me, every knee will bow, every tongue will swear. They will say of me, in the Lord alone are righteousness and strength, and all who have raged against him will come to him and be put to shame. God promised an oath to himself. And he says this, every knee will bow before me. Every tongue will confess that I am God. And we're going to do a practical exercise right now. And I know it's a little bit late on Sunday morning. And I know this is going to be uncomfortable. But I'm going to, God is simply saying this. The men in this church, if you've never bowed before me, physically bowed before me, then why not? What God do you serve? The God of pride? And with everyone seated in this church, God is calling right now for every man to get out of your chair and come to this altar and bow before him. Listen to me. It takes a man to worship God. It takes a man to be a man of God. But some of your wives in this room have begged and prayed in their closet today to see their husband bow before God Almighty. And sometimes it takes being uncomfortable and forced in a situation like this. If Greg can force me to bow before him in front of everybody, there's a good chance that I just might bow again in my home. And I don't know what you're coming up to bow for. We called for the fear of God to fall in this room at the very beginning. And some of you right now are going to give up pornography. That your wife has no idea. The reason you're not interested in her in the bedroom is because the sexual perversion that has ripped through your mind. And she's not even attractive anymore. Because she's not what's on the computer. Or simply this, I've been a spiritual coward in my home, and she's carried the weight of a family. She's the one praying for those kids. She's the one praying for this. I've been a spiritual coward, Father. Forgive me for being a spiritual coward. Christianity is about a serious God who there is no compromise in Him. There is no compromise in Jehovah. There was no compromise in His Son. There was no compromise in His Son. Fear of God, fall! Fear of God, fall! The reverent fear of God. Men and women, you'll bow for Him in judgment, or you'll bow for Him as an act of reverence. I choose an act of reverence. That, Father, I bow before You as an act of reverence, for I fear You out of a love for You. Father, I repent for allowing sin in my home. I repent for compromising with the devil. I repent that my children do not have reverence for God. This is how you devil-proof your home. It's a play on words, but the way you devil-proof your home is you put fear in the house. You put the fear of God. Every man in this building protects their home for things that are on the outside to cause fear to you and your family. But God says the way you devil-proof your house is you put fear within the house. You put the fear of God. Because where the fear of God is, sin flees. The fear of God is when there's a young man dating your daughter. The fear of God is if dad walks in the basement while we're alone. The fear of God is there's nothing going on that shouldn't be going on. And there's men in this room who've let young men into their house. And why these young men have their hands down in your daughter's pants. It's number one, they don't fear you. And there's no fear of God in that young man. And if there was fear in you and fear of God in your home, your daughter would not allow it to happen. There's men in this room today who are not married, and you're going to make a decision, you and your girlfriend, of whether we're going to break up for a period of time and we're going to seek God. For right now, both of you have become prostitutes. Economic benefit for hooking up. I ask God, as we prepare this, there's no way to make devil proof in your house funny. There's no way to make this a fun sermon, show cool videos, put a lot of statistics up there. It's men on their knees. It's men in the prone position, worshiping a mighty God, saying, "Have mercy upon me, Son of David. Have mercy upon me."
If you're a wife in this house and you've been guilty of not honoring your husband in the spot that he's in, maybe today's the day that you come forward and in a sign of submission to your husband, you follow him as he honors Christ. Maybe you're the mom. Maybe dad's not in the home. But you know, as priest of the home, you need to honor Christ in that home. This altar's open. This altar's open for women who want to follow the leading, not only of the men in their home, but the leading of Christ in your home. When your children see that you're not ashamed to kneel before the King of Kings, now you have set the example and you've opened the door for the presence to reside in your house. There are some women in this room right now that you have fought your husband to come through these doors. You have fought him as he's disciplined your children. You have wrestled with the reins of the home. This morning is the morning where you lay it down and you choose submission so that authority and the presence reigns in your home.
I see the Lord making some changes in homes later today. I see DVDs going in the trash. I see TVs being removed from where they were at, computers removed from where they were at. I see men of God asking their wife to forgive them. I see men and women going to their children and say, "Forgive me, for we've not shown you what the fear of God is supposed to be like in a home. Forgive me for compromising." God desires to heal your marriage. If you're here today and your marriage is in trouble, and I assure you there's somebody with a marriage in trouble, this is how you heal it. This is the first step. I implore you, pull out the peace flag, the white flag, when you leave this building today. Quit accusing one another. Spend some time together in prayer, and some of you marriages have never, ever done that. Pull out the white flag and repent together before God. Go to your bedroom. Clean out your bedroom. Go to your children's bedroom. Clean out the things that have an occultic agenda. Video games, trash them. Books, trash them. You'll stand accountable for letting occultic images, items in your home. There are going to be boyfriends and girlfriends who break up later today. And some of you are going to have a broken heart. I'd rather you have a broken heart for a short period of time than burn in hell forever. I don't care if you break up. Break up! There's some young couples in here that are beginning to date. You have no business dating. You have no business dating because the evil still within you from a sinful past is not yet dead. And you'll pull that young man or that young girl away from the kingdom of God. And your blood will be on his hands. Or his blood. Jesus, Jesus. If I'll have the, if you guys go ahead and stand up, if you choose to, if you want to lay before the Lord, go ahead. If the prayer team will come forward.
For those of you that maybe knelt today for the first time, make this a practice in your home. Make this a practice that you and your wife together bow before the Lord in your home. And don't be afraid to demand the same from your children.
Listen to me. As we end this service, the prayer warriors up front, there's nothing too embarrassing to tell anybody up here if you feel led to share. But listen to me. If pride has ever kept you from coming up and being prayed for, put the pride down. If your marriage needs prayer, men, if you need prayer, women, you need prayer, come find somebody. Come find somebody. Y'all, if you would just stand, please. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I praise your name. There is no one like you, Father. There is no one like you, Father. Father, I ask that your spirit rest upon the hearts and the minds of the people here today. Father, you're calling for a pure bride. You're calling for a pure bride. Father, I bless this congregation. I bless your marriages by the authority of Jesus Christ. By the authority of Jesus Christ, I bless your marriages. By the authority of Christ Jesus, parents, I bless your parenting. I bless your children. By the blood of Jesus Christ, that no weapon formed against them will prosper. Singles, I bless you to find a man or woman of God who loves God more than he'll love you. For if he'll love God more than you, he'll treat you like a king or queen. And I bless you to find that man or woman of God if you're single and desiring a husband or wife. I bless you. I bless the peace. I bless the authority of God to ride on every person within the sound of my voice. You have the authority of the King within you. You have the authority of the King to kick the devil out of your house. I bless you. In Jesus' name. If you need prayer, come forward. If you need prayer, please come.